स्टार्ट अंदर साथ मारते हैं। गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू द फर्स्ट ऑनलाइन लाइव स्ट्रीमिंग क्लास। टुडे वी आर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट स्पेसिमेन कलेक्शन एंड प्री एनालिटिकल एरर्स इन क्लिनिकल बायोकेमिस्ट्री लैबोरेटरी। दिस इज प्योरली अ डायग्नोस्टिक लैबोरेटरी सब्जेक्ट एंड आई विल ट्राई टू मेक इट एज सिंपल एज पॉसिबल। व्हाट यू मीन बाय क्वालिटी अश्योरेंस इन लैबोरेटरी? यू मस्ट हैव हर्ड ऑफ दिस टर्म्स मेनी अ टाइम, दिस वर्ड मेनी अ टाइम्स। We expect quality in every service or product that we receive, right? So the same applies to the medical field as well as the diagnostic field also. So nearly 70 to 85% of clinical decisions are based on the laboratory test results. Maintenance of a desired level of quality in the service or product provided is what is known as quality assurance. That is, we are assuring of the quality of the service that we are providing. World Health Organization defines quality assurance as the total process whereby the quality of the laboratory reports generated can be guaranteed. It can be summarized as the right results at the right time on the right specimen from the right patient with the result interpretation based on right reference data and at right price. So we need to look into all these aspects to call it as a quality result. So it can briefly be explained as it fit for the purpose or right for the first time itself. This is the quality assurance in the total testing process, wherein if there is a clinical question aroused by a clinician, that is a test has been ordered by a clinician, okay? So the entire laboratory process will be conveniently divided into pre-analytical phase, analytical phase, and post-analytical phase. The actual testing process will limit itself to the analytical phase. There are certain procedures to be followed before the analytical phase. This is known as pre-analytical phase, and it includes sample collection, sample handling, and then transportation and storage of the sample and till it is analyzed. Then the analytic phase is actually the analysis of the given sample for the test requested. Once the analysis is over, it is documented properly and it has to be sent in the form of a report, right? So all these will come under post analytical phase, okay? So this is another pictorial representation for showing the laboratory testing cycle. These are thanks to the automation, we have greatly reduced the errors due to analytical part of it. Okay. As I already explained you, there are three phases of laboratory testing: pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical. Though we concentrate mainly on analytical part of it, there are many important aspects in pre-analytical and post-analytical aspects which we need to address and try to minimize the errors. So I repeat, the pre-analytical part of laboratory testing includes ordering of the test by the clinician, preparation of the patient for that particular test, collecting appropriate sample, and handling the specimen, which includes its transportation, processing, and storage. Analytical part includes testing the given sample for the test requested, and recording of the results without any mistake. It can be either by manual method or electronic method. The post-analytical phase includes reporting of the results, interpretation of the results, follow-up of the patient, and retesting if required. So this is another representation of the phases of laboratory cycle. I hope you understand as of now that pre-analytical phase includes many subdivisions under itself, and the analytical phase includes the actual testing and comparing it with the quality aspects, and the post-analytical phase includes record keeping and reporting. So, coming to the pre-analytical phase, okay, the diagnostic laboratories per se can be attached to the hospital itself, or it can be a standalone lab, or there may be collection centers, multiple collection centers for a single laboratory. So, for all practical purposes, we assume that it is a standalone lab or a collection center, okay, and then we proceed regarding sample collection. Now, what is the first thing that you need to observe when you receive a sample request for laboratory analysis? The laboratory request form should contain the following information. What is it? It needs to contain general information regarding the patient and health related information. Under the general information, it has to contain the patient name, age or the date of birth, gender, identification number. It is very important to note that the identification number is correct, because there might be many patients with the same name, age, etc. Okay, you need to collect the contact details of the patient, address, and you also you need to know who the referring doctor is. You also need to collect information regarding the health or disease status of the patient, as to what is the provisional diagnosis, is he undergoing any treatment, is he undergoing any antibiotic treatment specifically, and collection date and time when you are collecting it. Once you receive the laboratory requisition in its order, you need to identify the patient that you are actually collecting the sample from the right patient. Okay, so how do you identify? Identification is a three-step process. That is, you ask the patient for the details, you compare it with the requisition, and then you validate and then proceed for sample collection. Okay, bedside labeling is very essential. Okay, it can be in the form of manual or electronic system for labeling, and no pre-labeling is allowed. Okay, once again, you need to verify the test that has been requested. Okay, now what is this patient preparation? Once you receive an order for a test, there may be certain tests which can be done during that part of the day itself, or there may be certain tests which require prior preparation from the patient. For example, if the test requested is either fasting blood sugar or postprandial blood sugar, okay, you need to ask the patient whether he is fasting for nearly 10 to 12 hours overnight. If yes, yes, you can proceed with a collection of blood sample. Otherwise, you need to explain the patient how he has to come prepared for the next day for giving the blood sample. Similarly for postprandial blood sugar, okay, it is nearly 2 hours after the proper meal that you will take the blood and estimate the sugar levels here. And even for lipid profile, we prefer fasting sample for lipid profile parameters. Okay, and serum cortisol is one such volatile parameter, and it is very much dependent upon the biological clock. Okay, so it has to be, the sample has to be collected at a particular time of a day, that is preferably 9 a.m. in the morning for serum cortisol estimations. So if he ends up to your laboratory at some other time, you please ask the patient to come prepared for the next day. Even the oral glucose tolerance test, the preparation for undergoing oral glucose tolerance test starts nearly 3 days prior to the date of testing. Okay, this has been covered in detail during carbohydrate metabolism classes. Okay, now how do we collect the specimen? What are the procedures involved and what are the prerequisites for collecting the same? Here is a picture of a lady collecting the sample from a patient. Let us look into the details. Now, what are the types of biological samples that are usually analyzed in the laboratory? The clinical request from the doctor itself will indicate the type of sample and the time of collection for that particular sample. Okay, these are the most commonly analyzed fluids or tissues. The most commonly analyzed body fluid is blood, and it can be whole blood or plasma or serum depending on the analyte requested. And most commonly, we perform the analysis on the venous blood unless it requires arterial blood, for example, arterial blood gas analysis or capillary blood in case of point of care testing or when the sample required is too less, etc. Urine is the next most widely analyzed biological sample. Feces can also be analyzed for stool examination. Other body fluids like saliva, spinal fluid, synovial fluid, amniotic, pleural, pericardial, and ascitic fluid analysis have been widely performed. And last but not the least, semen analysis for investigating the cases of infertility. And there can be a request for the examination of the tissue or cells for histopathological examination or cytological examination. Now, how do we collect the blood sample? Out of all these samples, we will in detail know about how exactly are we going to collect the blood sample. What are the sites of blood collection? There's a term known as phlebotomy, also known as vein puncture, which means we are inserting a needle into a vein in order to collect the blood. Phleb is nothing but vein, otomy is nothing but cutting. So we are cutting or puncturing a vein in order to collect the blood for analysis. Okay. Arterial blood can be, actually collecting arterial blood can be challenging and it has to be performed by a specially trained doctor or technician. Okay. And capillary blood or dermal puncture may at times be indicated when you need to perform the point of care testing or in infants and old patients where it is really difficult to access the blood and when only a minute amount of blood is required for conducting some tests. It is done by pricking the skin. Now, historically, how was phlebotomy performed? It was performed by using medicinal leeches, wherein they were applied to the skin of sick people. Okay. Now, coming to the sample timing. It is also important that you pay attention towards the time as to when exactly you're collecting the sample. Because certain tests, as already mentioned, like for example, fasting blood glucose measurements or lipid profile requires the patient to be under fasting conditions. Okay. So you need to pay attention whether that particular test requires fasting condition or non-fasting condition. And time-related changes in concentration of glucose and alcohol has been very widely noted. So it is very important that you analyze for glucose or alcohol as soon as the sample is received. And there might be unstable analytes such as bilirubin which you need to perform. So you have to take proper precautions if you cannot perform it as soon as you receive it. So how exactly are you going to store the sample? You have to store the sample for bilirubin in amber colored blood collection tubes. There can be an element of diurnal variation or circadian rhythm on certain elements such as cortisol. So when you receive a request for cortisol estimation, okay, you need to look at the time, okay, and also therapeutic drug monitoring. And there can be influence of certain drugs on a certain lab test. So you need to pay attention on whether the patient has already taken medication or not. Also about IV fluids. And you also need to pay attention about the hormonal cycle, especially when you're performing hormone analysis in case of an patient for infertility. Okay, you need to know whether the patient is in proliferative phase or secretory phase of menstrual cycle. Now, once you decide to perform the test, the technician performing the test should wear all the personal protective equipment like glove, mask, etc. You have to inquire whether the patient has any history of allergy to latex because the gloves and tunics are mostly made up of latex. Once you are ready to collect the sample, make sure that the patient is comfortably positioned. That is, he should be either seated or in the supine position. Never perform phlebotomy on a standing patient. And the arm from where you're collecting the blood sample has to be extended straight from wrist to the shoulder. Now, what are the different sample containers okay, that you use for collecting the sample. Okay, you have to choose the container which is appropriate for the test requested. Make sure that the expiry is not yet over and it is stable, and you have to make sure that the sample is properly mixed once it is collected. These are the different types of blood collection tubes or vacutainers used for routine analysis. So what are these red top tubes? These tubes or vacutainers contain red colored top to indicate that it doesn't contain any anticoagulant or preservative. It is routinely used for collecting serum for most of the chemistry analysis and also for blood bank specimens. Nearly 10 to 15 minutes is required for the blood to clot before centrifuging. So once you collect the sample in red top tubes and before you subject it to centrifugation, allow it to clot for nearly 15 minutes. And special type of tubes are designed for glucose estimation. They are gray top tubes. You can remember it this way: gray for G and glucose for G. So gray top tubes are used for estimating glucose. This is because immediately after collection, the glucose concentration decreases significantly because of ongoing cellular metabolism. So we have designed gray top tubes in such a way that it contains sodium fluoride, and this inhibits the enzyme enolase of glycolysis pathway. So the degradation of glucose is arrested, and so you can estimate the glucose at a later point of time also. Then you have lavender top tubes, which contain potassium salt of EDTA. This EDTA will chelate calcium, which is very much required for clot formation, and so it inhibits coagulation. This is routinely used for hematological analysis and some chemistries, but it cannot be used for potassium or calcium testing. Then you have green top tubes, okay, which contain sodium or potassium or lithium salt of heparin. Basically, green top tubes are heparinized tubes. It is most widely used anticoagulant for all the chemistry analysis, but it should not be used for the determination of sodium or potassium or lithium, since the preservative itself contains these elements. It can affect the size and integrity of blood components, and so it is not routinely recommended for hematological studies. Heparin also accelerates the action of antithrombin 3 and makes sure that the blood doesn't clot. The advantage of using plasma is that we don't need to waste time waiting for the blood to clot. Then you have rarely used tubes, which are gold color tubes. Okay, they contain a gel that forms a physical barrier between the serum and the cells. No other additives will be used. Okay, this gel barrier may affect some of the lab tests, so it is not very widely used. Then you have brown and royal blue top tubes. They are specially designed for trace metal studies. The brown top tubes are especially used for lead analysis, and the royal blue top tubes are used for other trace element analysis. Coming to the anticoagulants or the preservatives which are used for analyzing the various samples, the most commonly used ones are the sodium citrate for prothrombin time, EDTA disodium salt for hematological studies, and lithium heparin for most chemistry analysis, and sodium fluoride for estimating glucose. As I already told you, fluoride will inhibit enolase enzyme of glycolytic pathway and diminishes the degradation of glucose. Now, how about the needles that we need to use? Okay, routinely used needles are of 18 to 25 gauze size. Remember that the bigger the gauze size, the smaller the bore or the lumen of the needle. Okay, for children, we recommend the sizes between 22 to 23. We have to choose the minimum size in order to achieve the quality sample. Size smaller than required is more likely to cause hemolysis. If it is too larger, it may cause trauma to the patient. Okay, so if you're collecting large volumes of blood, so you can use 18 or even wider, more needed. Now, which is the location for venipuncture? The most commonly advocated vein is the median cubital vein, which is located in the antecubital fossa, because this vein is big enough and it is very close to skin for us to access. If for some reason you cannot access this vein, then you can also prefer choosing it from back of the hand or ankle. Okay. In case of inpatients, it is advisable to collect blood during the insertion of IV cannula itself. And if it is necessary to collect blood from arm with running fluids, that is IV fluids, make sure that you shut off the fluid for at least 3 minutes, okay, before collecting. And you have to discard the first 5 ml of the collected blood in order to minimize the interferences. And you have to use a site below the infusion site so that the retrograde blood flow through veins doesn't occur. Now, you have to use tourniquet in order to cause venous occlusion. Why do we need to occlude the veins? In order to distend the veins. How do you place the tourniquet? You have to place it nearly 4 to 6 inch above the intended puncture site and make sure that it doesn't stay in place for more than 1 minute, because it is known to increase the risk of hemolysis by nearly 20%. You have to remove the tourniquet or loosen the tourniquet once the blood starts flowing into the tube. Alternatively, if you do not have the provision for tourniquet, you can also use a BP cuff with a pressure not more than 60 millimeter mercury. Why should you avoid hemolysis is because it is known to raise the concentration of potassium or LFT parameters, while hemo concentration causes increase in serum protein, potassium and lactic acid. And you have to avoid pumping and tapping of hand while collecting. Now, how do you prepare the site? You have to disinfect the site with prepackaged alcohol. Okay, gauze pad saturated with 70% isopropanol can be used, or benzalkonium chloride solution will also serve the purpose. Make sure that you clean the puncture site from inside out, that is from the site where you are intending it to puncture outwards, okay, in a circular motion. And once you clean it, you should let the skin to dry, because the alcohol in the disinfecting solution can cause hemolysis and can interfere with the results. Now, about the aspiration of the sample. The rule for aspiration is that you have to aspirate slowly. Okay. So, for achieving the same, you can use an evacuated blood tube known as vacutainer, which is totally filled with vacuum. Okay. It allows direct filling of the tubes. Okay. The advantage is that it is very convenient and easy, but it also has a drawback because it is costlier. And if you use a syringe for collecting the blood sample, make sure that you maintain 15 degree contact angle. Then you have specimen volume. Okay. It's very important that you collect the sample in adequate volume, because this is the second most common cause for sample rejection. Okay. Ensure that there is correct ratio between the sample volume and the additive. Okay. If it is underfilled, it can cause hemolysis, it can change the morphology of cells, and it can prolong the coagulation studies. If it is overfilled, it can delay the clotting process, and it can also create microclots. So you have to note the points which have been marked for maximum fill and minimum fill, and you have to take appropriate volume of sample for that test requested. And once you load the vacutainer with the or the sample collection tube with the blood, make sure that you invert them by rotating it through vertically upwards and then downwards. Then how do you seal the puncture site? Your job is not over just after you collect the blood sample. You have to properly seal the puncture site, okay, using a sterile swab. And labeling is very, very important. And you are advised to label after every collection. No batch labeling is allowed to avoid confusions and mistakes, okay? So you have to put the sticker right neatly on the tube after collecting the sample, okay? And the needle which you used for collecting the sample has to be destroyed and discarded using the needle cutter. And you have to autoclave all the disposables. Now, suppose a single patient has been asked for multiple tests, okay? So what is the order of collection of blood, okay? So initially, if the patient has been requested for blood culture, the very initial amount of blood has to be transferred for the blood culture bottles, followed by coagulation studies, and then the ESR, okay? Then comes the serum tube, the red top tubes, okay? Then the heparin tubes, then all other anticoagulants, and finally comes the gray top tubes for estimating glucose. So this is the order of draw. Once you collect the blood sample, it is your responsibility to make sure that you achieve transportation, storage and stability properly. So transport conditions has to be met with respect to temperature and light. Make sure that there is no vibration during transportation of sample. And historically, they were using pneumatic tube systems for blood gas analysis. Okay, make sure that you follow the centrifugation protocols and freeze-thaw cycles. That is storing the sample in the refrigerator. Okay, if there is delay in analysis or if you are preserving the sample for some other testing, and thawing. Thawing is taking out the sample from the low temperature. Okay, in order to adjust to the room temperature. Centrifugation. Okay. Specimen without anticoagulant, like for example, the red top tubes, is centrifuged only after the clot is formed. I told you initially that you need to allow it for nearly 10 to 15 minutes for the blood to clot. Only then you can take it for centrifugation. Okay. If suppose the specimen is without anticoagulant, then you can centrifuge it as soon as possible. Okay. Immediate serum separation is required for analytes such as glucose and cortisol. And it's important that you protect the sample from light for analytes such as bilirubin and vitamin A, because these are known to undergo photodegradation. That is, they will degrade spontaneously when they are exposed to light. Then, this finishes about venous blood collection. How are we collecting arterial blood? The most common indication for this is arterial blood gas analysis. And as I already mentioned, it is a special, it requires special training and can be performed only by doctors or specially trained technicians. The common sites for performing arterial blood analysis is the radial artery, the brachial artery, or the femoral artery, in that order. Now, it's very important that you transport the specimen immediately to the point of testing. Okay, and make sure that you are not transferring the arterial blood to another container. You are as it is collecting the sample in a heparinized syringe, and it has to be immediately transported to the lab, because every second the values changes because you are analyzing the blood gases. Now, what about capillary blood collection? Here, the skin is punctured with the help of a lancet in order to collect small volume of blood. Where is it commonly used? It is used when you require limited sample volume, or you can get only limited sample volume, as in pediatric wards, or when the vein is severely damaged due to repeated venipunctures, or when there is burn or bandaged areas in the usually collecting sites. And when the blood collected on special filter papers for neonatal screening and molecular genetic testing. So what are the sites for capillary blood collection? It is usually the tip of a finger, okay? Or earlobe can also be punctured, or it is heel or big toe in case of infants. How exactly do you collect the capillary blood? You have to clean the site, okay? Puncture with a sharp stab not deeper than 1 inch. Okay, and you have to use different site for each puncture, okay, in order to prevent infection. Do not press or massage the finger or the site, okay, in order to avoid the tissue fluid oozing out. And the first drop is usually wiped off, and the subsequent drops are collected in appropriate collection tubes. Fill rapidly as the site will clot. Now, these are some of the blood collection equipments: needles, needle disposer, syringe, blood collection tubes or vacutainers, butterfly needle for infants, lancet for collecting capillary blood through dermal puncture, micro containers, tourniquet, adhesive strip for sealing the site, gloves, which is a part of personal protective equipment, etc. Now we move on to discuss regarding how we collect the sample of urine or feces or other body fluids. There are many ways of collecting the urine sample. Random urine sample, it can be collected at any point of the day. Early morning sample, okay, it is usually advised, and double voided specimen is usually advised for glucose tolerance test. Midstream sample, it is advised for bacteriological examination. Okay, if suppose you cannot collect the urine in any of these manner, if suppose the patient is severely ill or comatose, then you need to perform catheterization in order to draw the urine sample. Okay, if suppose there is a urethral stricture or tumor or obstruction to the urethra, and it cannot be normally collected, as then you can always go for suprapubic aspiration of urine from the bladder. And 24-hour urine sample is advocated for few tests, like for example urinary protein analysis. Even for collecting the urine, you may use certain preservatives. Okay, these are the substances which reduce the bacterial action or the chemical decomposition, and it will solubilize certain constituents. Okay, the commonly used urinary preservatives are HCl, sodium carbonate, sodium hydroxide, toluene, and light petroleum. Okay, we also use certain other urine preservatives. This I already discussed, which are the conditions where you take different types of urine samples. Coming to the collection of feces when a stool examination is requested, okay, you will analyze the stool for fecal fat, parasites, heme or occult blood, and fecal nitrogen content. Okay, if there is fecal fat, you can always suspect that the patient has obstructive jaundice or malabsorption. Okay, parasites may be found in the stools using microscopy. You can also find the cysts and ova of various parasites. Okay, and occult blood may be found in case of gastrointestinal bleeding, and you can also estimate fecal nitrogen for cases of malabsorption. Okay, care has to be taken to prevent contamination with urine while collecting the stool sample, and the fresh specimens have to be used, okay, in order to avoid the need for preservatives. Now, what are the other body fluids that are routinely analyzed in a laboratory? CSF, this is cerebrospinal fluid, and the procedure for collecting the same is the lumbar puncture. Okay, what are the indications for performing CSF analysis? It is basically requested in cases of meningitis, cerebrovascular accidents, demyelinating diseases, and in order to know the involvement of meninges in malignant disease. There is also contraindication for performing lumbar puncture if there is too much of intracranial pressure in infants and children, because it can cause instant death in such people because of medullary coning. Then you can also perform analysis on ascitic fluid. Okay, how do you collect it? With the help of abdominal tap. Okay, and it has to be performed in the most dependent portion with maximum dullness. This is with respect to the clinical examination of the patient concerned. It is most commonly advocated in patients with cirrhosis and peritonitis. You may also receive test requests for performing analysis on pleural fluid or pericardial fluid in respective effusions. Amniotic fluid can also be sent for analysis, okay, for prenatal diagnosis of certain congenital disorders, for assessing fetal maturity, and also Rh isoimmunization. So the way in which you collect amniotic fluid is known as amniocentesis. So this was about collection of samples for various types of samples. Now, what is the sample contamination? Even after taking all the possible precautions, at times there may be contamination of the sample with because of hemolysis or the anticoagulants used, or if the patient is already on IV fluids, that may also interfere with analysis. If the patient is on total parenteral nutrition, or it may be contaminated by bacteria also. So we look into the details of each of these contaminants. Okay. So if there is sample contamination by hemolysis, okay, this is very important that you prevent hemolysis as far as possible, because most of the samples, that is 60% of the sample rejections in laboratory, is basically due to hemolysis. It is most commonly due to vigorous suction from the syringe, forceful transfer from the syringe, or soap in the test tube, or vigorous shaking. So it's very important that you consciously avoid doing all these vigorous activities during sample collection and transfer. If there is hemolysis, there is red cell destruction and hemoglobin release. Okay, because of the red cell destruction, there can be increase in potassium content, acid phosphatase, LDH, and aspartate transaminase levels in blood. So it can lead to pseudo hyperkalemia. It can also derange certain liver function tests and can affect coagulation studies. Now, sample contamination with anticoagulants. Okay, so if you have collected the sample in heparinized tubes, it can affect coagulation studies. EDTA tubes, sample in EDTA tubes can interfere with estimations of potassium, calcium, ALP, and magnesium. And though in green colored heparinized tubes, okay, better you avoid estimating lithium. Then, what about the sample contamination with IV fluids? You should always use the alternate arm if possible. That means the arm where the IV fluids are not running. Okay. Wait for the IV fluid to be stopped for at least 5 minutes before collecting the sample. Okay. And mention it on the request form. You have to mention that the fluid, the sample was collected from the arm where IV fluids were running. Now, why should you avoid all this? Because it has certain effects. If suppose the patient was given saline, okay, all the results may get diluted, and there can also be interferences by the sodium and chloride contained in the saline. Okay, if it is potassium chloride, potassium and chloride can affect the results. If it is dextrose, again, all the results may get diluted, and it can also interfere with estimation of glucose. Now, sample collection contamination with total parenteral nutrition. Okay, there can be lipemia. Okay, so can you notice lipemia here? Okay, it can interfere with the analysis of most chemistry analytes. Okay, and it can also lead to pseudo hyponatremia. And if suppose you're collecting sample from a patient with total parenteral nutrition. Now, what is this total parenteral nutrition? For example, comatose patients, the patient is not able to take the oral feeds. Okay, in order to allow sustainability of the patient, we will provide the nutrition through parenteral route, that is other than the usual GI route. Okay, that is through IV. Okay, so if you are collecting the sample from such patients, you need to mention it on the request form. And there can be possible contamination of the sample with bacteria. It is relatively uncommon. Okay. So, as far as possible, you need to avoid. Certain factors are known to affect the lab results. Okay, we will discuss one by one. Okay, the patient age, gender, and ethnicity can definitely have a effect on the laboratory results. Obesity can affect because then it might be difficult to palpate the vein in such patients, okay? And the patient anxiety and stress levels can also alter certain parameters. Exercise, if heavy exercise has been done by the patient, it can affect on proteinuria, LD isoenzyme, CKMB, etc. Caffeine can also increase free fatty acid content, total lipids and glucose. Smoking is known to increase triglyceride growth hormone, cortisol, glucose, urea, and known to decrease HDL cholesterol. And the medications that the patient is on, okay, are known to alter the laboratory results. For example, if the patient is on hepatotoxic drugs, it can increase the liver enzymes. Okay, certain medications which affect the plasma volume can affect protein, CBC, urea nitrogen, iron, and calcium. Age and disease state also alters the laboratory results. Like, for example, geriatric oncology patients or hematological patients can have fragile veins. Okay, so there is difficulty in collecting sample, and there can be increased risk of hemolysis in such patients. Okay, pediatric patients will have small veins, so there might be traumatic collection, or there can be collapsed veins leading to vessel valve injury and hemolysis. So you need to take proper precautions. And body position also has a bearing on the laboratory results. How is it done? Changing from supine position to sitting position can cause blood vessel constriction, and changing from sitting to supine position will cause fluid shifts and cause hemoconcentration. Okay, so it can affect the results of complete blood count. Lipemia. Okay, so the increased amount of lipid in the blood. Okay, there can be displacement of plasma volume and short sampling. Okay, it basically interferes with spectrophotometric analysis or turbidimetric measurements. These are the equipments or the methods for analyzing certain chemistry analytes. Icterus, that is yellowish discoloration of the sample, it can affect several colorimetric assays. And blood collection near the site of infusion, like if the patient is on IV fluids, okay, it can cause contamination or dilution. There can be traumatic draw leading to vessel wall injury. Okay, you have to concentrate on the sample volume also, because overfilling and underfilling has its own effects. Okay, liquid additives can also have add an element of dilution factor. Inadequate mixing of the sample will lead to microclot formation. Okay, excessive mixing or vigorous inversions can lead to hemolysis. Better to avoid all these. The other factors include the serum clotting time. You have to allow the serum to clot adequately, okay? And the timing of the sample analysis is very important. And if suppose the sample has been collected at a site other than the laboratory place where the analytes are analyzed, okay, it has to be immediately transported. Like, for example, for ABG analysis, every second matters, okay? So during transportation, it's very important that you maintain proper temperature even during storage. Okay, the transport container has to be properly sealed. Now, there are certain pre-analytical variables which can affect laboratory results. As you already know, the pre-analytical phase of laboratory testing includes selection of the right test, sampling, transportation to the place of analysis, registration and storage till it is analyzed, preparation of the sample, and then distribution to the different counters of the laboratory, and then sample preparation before actual analysis. So out of all the factors which affect laboratory results, okay, the certain of this pre-analytical variables are controllable, like, for example, this collection of specimen, labeling, transport, handling, processing. It will be in our hands, okay? We can always control the variability. But there are certain uncontrollable variables like biological variation, environmental conditions, smoking, postural changes, the diet, medication, physical activity, stress, and lipemia and jaundice, okay? So you need to bear in mind both controllable and uncontrollable pre-analytical variables before releasing the results. Now, there can be errors in the laboratory medicine, like it can be there in any other field. To err is human, right? So, coming to the statistics of the laboratory errors, nearly 10 to 20% of errors can negatively influence on healthcare quality, and more than 3% of errors have a direct bearing on patient safety. So, the bottom line is, more the number of tests, more the chances for errors, okay? We have to consciously avoid causing errors. Now, how do you define this laboratory error? It is a defect occurring at any part of the laboratory cycle, right from the test ordering, to analyzing, to reporting results, to interpreting, and to reacting to these issues. Errors in laboratory medicine can be broadly classified into pre-analytical errors, that is from test ordering to till the time it is taken for analysis, okay, and it accounts for nearly 62% of the total laboratory errors. Analytical errors will only constitute 15% thanks to the automation which has greatly reduced the analytical errors, and the errors in the post-analytical phase will nearly account for nearly 23% of total laboratory errors. So, here you can note that the most of the errors are occurring in the pre-analytical phase. Now it is high time that we automate many of the subdivisions of pre-analytical phase. Now what are the consequences of error? Each error made prior to the sample testing alters the final report. Okay, error can be in either pre-analytical, analytical or post-analytical phase, but it finally has a bearing on the final report, and it affects the quality of treatment given to the patient. So it is our responsibility to minimize the errors at each of these phases. Now coming to the pre-analytical errors, the most common reasons for pre-analytical errors are missing sample. The sample itself may go missing, hemolysis, misidentification of the sample with the patient, sampling error, there can be wrong tube or wrong technique, tourniquet time, sample mixing can be problematic, you might not have allowed the sample to clot, or the sample or the request itself is missing, or wrong patient preparation, or there can be problems in transportation or centrifugation, okay? And deciding on the inappropriateness of sample based on the visual inspection of lipemia, ichthyosis and hemolysis is highly unreliable, and it should be replaced by automated system. I am trying to give you certain examples for the pre-analytical errors. This is an example of inappropriate test request. Why? Because you can note here that the age and gender of the patient has been mentioned as 22-year female, and they have requested for prostate-specific antigen. So, prostate-specific antigen in a female patient is an inappropriate test request. There can be errors in the order entry, okay? So, actually the patient name might be Anita, okay? But you might have written it as Ananta, something like this. And there can be incomplete request form, like you can note here that the doctor details, the history has been missed out. Misidentification of patient is very much possible. For example, if suppose the Jones Barbara is the name of the patient, okay, and you have two patients with the same name, if you don't pay attention towards the unique ID created by the hospital or the laboratory, there are high chances that you can interchange the results of one patient to the other patient with the same name. The container can be inappropriate, okay, so you have to use appropriate container for the test requested, okay. And there can be absent labeling, or maybe the label is torn off, okay? So make sure that labeling is properly made. And there can be mistakes in choosing the site, okay? So if you leave the tourniquet for prolonged periods, it can also have a bearing. Like for example, as I told you, prolonged tourniquet time will lead to hemolysis, and it can increase the concentration of potassium, calcium, ADH, AST, etc. And improper transportation is another pre-analytical error, okay? You have to maintain proper temperature while transportation, avoid exposure to light, and make sure that there is no vigorous shaking during transportation of sample. And collection from the infusion site. Okay, so suppose this is already in place, the infusion site is already in place, and you are trying to collect sample from the same site. Okay, there are high chances that it can lead to erroneous results. And make sure that the sample ratio to with respect to the anticoagulant is properly maintained. Okay, insufficient sample can also lead to erroneous results. Okay. So what if you don't avoid all these errors? What are the effects of these pre-analytical errors? There can be decreased efficiency. There can be problems with the patient safety, because most of the treatments, at least today, is depending on the laboratory results. There can be wrong diagnosis. There can be unnecessary treatment of a patient, or it can cause mistrust in patients. It can affect the reputation of the institute, and it also has a bearing on the financial aspects. So what are the costs of pre-analytical errors? If suppose you do not follow proper precautions while collecting the sample and handling it, okay, there can be a request for redraw of the sample, reanalysis, where the entire process has to be repeated. Instrument downtime may be there. Okay, patient treatment, okay, will get affected. There can be additional procedures performed on the patient, like for example, if CSF analysis has been asked, okay, and if it turned out to be giving erroneous results, okay, you need to perform the lumbar puncture again. There can be time and labor delay, and it can include legal costs. Now, what are the complications in blood collection? There can be failure to draw blood due to various reasons. Maybe the veins are collapsed, or the patient is dehydrated, etc. And certain patients do faint when they see their own blood. Okay, so there can be fainting, there can be hematoma at site, there can be oozing of tissue fluid, and so edema. Okay, there can be difficulty in access, as in case of obesity or dehydration. Okay, suppose the patient is on IV therapy, it will be problematic to collect blood from them. It can lead to hemoconcentration, collapsed veins, hemolysis, etc. What are the consequences of pre-analytical errors? Okay, so it can each of the process described under pre-analytical phase can have possible consequences, and it can be the degree of seriousness can be mild to moderate to severe. No. Are there any strategies for preventing laboratory errors? Yes, there are. So you have to develop clear written procedures and protocols for each of the procedures from pre-analytical to post-analytical stage. Okay. You can always enhance the training given to the healthcare professionals. Okay. And you can always automate the functions in order to avoid human-related errors. You need to compare with the quality indicators very frequently, and you need to improve the communication among healthcare professionals. So the total testing process improvement can be achieved by automation, improved technologies, standardization of the assays, informatics, but all these will help us achieve perfection, near perfection in the analytical part. But we are yet to develop automation in pre-analytical and post-analytical phase. Now, there are certain criteria where you can reject the sample if it doesn't fit the criteria. Okay, if suppose the specimen is unlabeled, you can straight away reject the specimen, because in order to avoid erroneous result. Okay, insufficient patient information, yes, you can reject. Hemolyzed sample, you can reject. Wrong tube used for drawing the specimen, you can reject. If you find there is lipemia, you can always reject and ask for recollection of the sample. If it is inadequate, if the sample is inadequate, then of course you can ask for resampling. If there is a prolonged transportation, then of course you can always ask for resampling. So the brunt of the burden laid on the lab personnel shoulder is really too much, and it is our duty to execute the duty with near perfection. Okay. So So these are certain solutions which I already discussed to maintain the laboratory errors. So finally, it's the patient safety and proper care which is the target. Okay. Thank you for your attention. Any doubts, you can post it in the group. It will be collectively answered in the next session. All the best. I'll leave it here.